So last time we finished discussing the convolution and how it behaves in the discrete case versus the continuous case. So it's more or less the same situation. Okay. So we discussed the convolution. We discussed the properties of the convolution, such as linearity of convolution, such as the width of the result of a convolution, right? And then we discussed also things like it's commutative, it's distributive, right? Okay. So we have discussed those things, which are very, very, very similar to the case of the continuous time systems. Now let's look at how you can figure out system properties, particularly two important properties, from the impulse response. Again, this is very similar to the case of discrete. So system properties from h of n, right? So now we are dealing with a discrete h of n, okay? So the two important ones are causality. Okay. So very similar to what we studied in the continuous case, a system is causal, a system. Of course, here we are talking about a linear time invariant system. Otherwise, H does not have a meaning, right? The impulse response only makes sense in case of linear time invariant system, right? Is causal if and only if, okay, H of K or H of N is equal to zero for all n less than zero, right? So this is exactly similar to the situation in the continuous time case, right? H of t is equal to zero for any time negative, right? Similarly here, h of n is equal to zero for any discrete time being negative, okay? So that's one thing. And the second property that you can also figure out easily from the impulse response of a system is stability. Okay, again, here we are talking about stability as defined by bounded input producing bounded output. So we call that BIBO stability, okay, or BIBO stability, okay. So for that case, again, a system, another time, this is linear time invariant, is stable if and only if, okay, the summation of over n from minus infinity to infinity, the absolute value of h of n, right, is smaller than infinity. So it's some finite value. Again, exactly the same with the difference that instead of using integration from minus infinity to infinity, here we use summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity. So if the total summation, which is the summation over all possible values of n, of the absolute value of the impulse response is finite, then the system for sure is stable. If it's not finite, then the system for sure is not stable, okay? So less than infinity means it's equal to some finite value, okay? Or it's bounded by a finite value, okay? So that's in terms of the system properties as you can deduce them from the impulse response of the system. Now the next important is, what if I want to find the Fourier series, okay, for discrete time periodic signal? Okay, so now we are starting to discuss frequency domain for discrete time signals and systems, okay? So very similar definition to the definition that we have studied for the Fourier series for the continuous case, right? Here we will stick only with the Fourier series representation as a complex exponential. So remember that one we used to call it dn, right? Yeah. So we are going to stick also with dn for the discrete case, only the coefficients for the complex exponential, because this is the most generalized and there is no need to complicate things and look at the cosine only and the cosine plus sine and all these things that we looked at in the continuous case. So per definition, x of n, right, a discrete time signal, x of n is equal to the summation from r equals 0 up to n naught minus 1, where n naught is the fundamental period. Of x of n. Okay, so x of n is periodic, and the fundamental period of that signal is n naught. Okay, so you can represent that signal x of n as a sum of complex exponentials, right? With coefficients, we call them in this case just to differentiate. We use the math cal, like the d, which is, looks fancy a little bit. Okay, and instead of using dn, to make sure that we are using something other than the time index, we call it dr. Okay, so our frequency index is going to be r. Okay, and instead of in the continuous case, we had x of t, function of continuous time, and then in frequency it became d of n, where n was the index of the frequency, right? At n omega naught, so omega naught to omega naught, 3 omega naught, and so on. Here at r omega naught, same thing, but just we want to use another variable to distinguish from the n, which is now being used for the time index. Yeah. Okay, so summation from r equals 0 up to n naught minus 1 dr multiplied by e to the j, and then r, which is the index, multiplied by omega naught, which is the fundamental frequency, multiplied by n, which is my time index. Okay, now what's omega naught? Omega naught is defined as what? 2 pi over n naught. Okay, so that's my fundamental frequency. So 2 pi over the period, over the fundamental period. Okay. So this is how dr are the frequency coefficients or the Fourier series coefficients of the signal x of n. Mm-hmm. Now, notice the difference here. We don't sum from minus infinity to infinity. We sum only over one period. Remember in the expression for the Fourier series expansion of continuous time, we used to sum from minus infinity to infinity. Correct? We used to write x of t is equal to the summation of n from minus infinity to infinity, dn multiplied by e to the j, n omega naught, right? T, right? Here, we don't have the summation from minus infinity to infinity in the definition of the Fourier series expansion. The summation is only over one fundamental period.
This yes. is because of the repetitive.
Exactly, because the frequency domain is repetitive, as we looked at last lecture. In frequency domain, when you look at the frequency representation of a discrete time signal, in frequency, that signal will have a periodic Fourier series expansion, right? A periodic frequency domain expansion, regardless whether it's Fourier series or not, okay? So that's why we sum only over one period here. We don't sum until infinity, okay? And then the definition of dr, how do you calculate dr itself? And I forgot to make it fancy, okay? So the definition of dr is equal to 1 over n naught, which is the fundamental period, and then summation from n equals 0 up to n naught minus 1, okay? So since we start from 0, we finish at n naught minus 1 because the number of points is going to be n naught, right? So always keep that in mind when you are dealing with discrete cases, okay? The period has n naught points. So if you start from 0, you have to finish at n naught minus 1, okay? So from n equals 0 up to n naught minus 1, x of n multiplied by e to the minus j r omega naught and then n, okay? So this is how you can, from the Fourier series coefficients, find out the time domain signal using the first one, right? So this is how you represent the signal as a summation of complex exponential. And this is how, if you know x of n, how you find the drs, which is based on this second equation. Now, again, because everything is periodic, you don't have to do the summation from 0 up to n minus 1, or from 0 up to n naught minus 1, sorry, okay? You can do the summation. You can do the summation over any period of n naught points, right? So you can write these definitions in a more generalized form as x of n is equal to the summation, and then we say this, over any n naught points. So you pick any number of points that are n naught, right? And then that is going to repeat anyways because the signal is periodic, right? It's periodic in time, And it is also periodic in frequency, okay? Because it's discrete. خلاص? So you can do the summation over any n node points, right? Okay, for r. So r over number of points equal to n node, and then the same thing, dr e to the j r omega node n, right? And if you want to deduce the dr itself, it's equal again to the summation for the time n over any points with number n node, and then don't forget to divide by the period here, and then it's x of n multiplied by e to the minus j r omega node n. And these are the more generalized form how you can find the Fourier series expansion of a discrete time periodic signal. So I have x of n, which is discrete time periodic signal, and I can express it as a summation of complex exponentials, and the coefficients here are called the Fourier series expansion of this discrete time periodic signal. And how to reduce these is shown by the second equation. And in both equations, the summation over any points, consecutive points, where they count up to n node. So first point, second point, third point, and so on, until point number n node. Doesn't matter, you take it from 0, you take it from 1, you take it from 2, you take it from 100, it doesn't matter. If you start at 100, you will finish at 100 plus n node minus 1, right? If you start from 2, you will finish at 2 plus n node minus 1. If you start from 0, you will finish at n node minus 1. Okay? So it doesn't matter where you work. It's a window of n node points. And we can take a quick example on that. So, example. Look at the signal x of n equal to sine 0.1 pi n. Okay? So this is my time domain signal. First of all, I need to check whether this signal is periodic or not, right? And then I can see if I can find the Fourier series for it or not. So the question says, check if x of n is periodic, and if yes, find its Fourier series expansion, okay, or coefficients, not expansion, coefficients. Dn, okay, or dr. Okay. So first, check whether it's periodic or not. If it is periodic, find its Fourier series coefficient dr. So check for periodic. How?
How do you check for periodic?
Yes.
Okay, so you have to check that, the value has to be like a fraction multiplied by 2 pi.
Yes, exactly. So omega node, or omega, sorry, in this case, omega is equal to pi over 10, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Because it's 0.1 pi, which is equal to what? 2 pi multiplied by 1 over 20. This is a fraction or not? It belongs to the rational numbers, right?
Yes.
So this means that this, it is periodic, right?
Yes.
Since it's equal to 2 pi times, let's say m over n, where m over n is or belongs to, right, the set of rational numbers. How do you call rational numbers? N?
Rational numbers?
Yeah.
Q.
Q? Yeah, a set of Q. You're right. Okay, so belongs to Q, the set of rational numbers. If you don't remember, just say belongs to the rational numbers and that's enough. Okay? So since it can be represented as 2 pi multiplied by a rational number, then it is periodic. Now, the second question is, before going to the Fourier series, you need to figure out what's omega node and what's n node, right? So for this one, what is omega node and accordingly n node, right? Because the one is just the inverse of the other. So how do you find that?
N node is 20, right?
Why?
Because it's the n and the fraction.
Yeah, so we said, if you remember, we said that the fundamental frequency has to be represented by?
The n and the frequency.
Yeah, so remember, what was the expression that we used before?
We said
that omega naught has to be equal to m multiplied by some fraction m over n,
yes,
right? Such that, okay, you find the smallest m that gives you an integer value,
yes,
right? And then when you find that, it was omega naught or n naught. This was the expression for n naught. Sorry. So n naught is equal to m multiplied by some m over n, okay? Such that you are trying to find the smallest m that gets you?
The n of n.
Yes, okay. So you are trying to find the smallest m that makes this an integer, right?
Yes.
And then this is going to be?
This is going to be the n of?
The expression was not this way. M over 2 pi over omega, right? Yeah.
Yeah,
m multiplied by 2 pi over omega, right? And then you find the smallest m that makes this an integer,
yeah,
right? And then in this case,
one, right?
This is gonna, sorry?
I think you said m is usually 1, right?
No, I didn't say it's usually 1. I said it's the smallest one that makes this fraction, when it's multiplied by m, it will give you an integer number, right? Then the result of all of this is going to be your n naught, right? So if you do 2 pi over omega, what will you get? 2 pi
over
2 pi over 20, right? Yes. This is omega. Omega is 2 pi over 20. So this is going to be what?
20.
So this is going to be m multiplied by 20. So what's the smallest value for m in this case?
1,
because it's already an integer, right? So basically, n naught is equal to 20 directly, because smallest m must be equal to 1. The smallest m that will result in this expression
being an integer
is just 1, right? You don't need to go to any higher value because it's already an integer.
So
if it was something like 20 over 3, then the smallest m would have been 3, right? And then when you multiply it, it's going to give you eventually a frequency equal to 20 as well.
So the small m is equal to the big M, right?
Lala, don't confuse things. No, there is no relation. Okay? Not always.
Okay. Not always?
Not always.
Okay, give us a case for
this. So anyways, not now. Okay? So n naught is equal to 20. Okay? So now we find that the fundamental frequency is equal to 20. Then this means immediately that omega naught is equal to 2 pi over n naught, which is equal to 2 pi over 20. So now I know my fundamental frequency and I know my fundamental period. What do I need to figure out? I need to figure out the Fourier series expansion. So the expression says dr is equal to 1 over n naught, right?
Yeah.
So what's n naught in this case?
20.
1 over 20, right?
Yeah.
And then the summation over n over any period. I will pick in this case, because it will make the solution easy, to start from minus 10 and finish at 10 minus 1. Right? So n equals minus 10 up to 9. How many points are included in this case? From minus 10 up to 9, it's 20 points. Yeah, 20 points, okay? So you start counting minus 10, minus 9, minus 8, minus 7. Count them up to 9, you will find that they are 20 points, which is going to be what you need. You only need to count over 20 points, the number of points in the period. خلاص يا جماعة? So from minus 9 up to, from minus 10 up to 9 is going to be 20 points. And then you do what? The summation of what? X of k. What's x of k? Sine 0.1 pi n. Or x of n, sorry. Okay? Multiplied by e to the minus j. Multiplied by r, my index. Right? Multiplied by omega naught. What's omega naught? It's 0.1 10 pi. Right? Multiplied by my time index, n. Okay? Now, I can express the sign also as two exponentials subtracted from each other and divided by 1 over 2j. So this is going to be equal to 1 over 40j, and then the summation from n equals minus 10 up to 9. And then the sign there is expressed as e to the j 0.1 pi n okay right minus e to the minus j 0.1 pi n. This is my sign, and the 1 over 2j I took it outside. So that's why I ended up with 1 over 40j, right? And then this is multiplied by e to the minus j r 0.1 pi n, right?
Yes.
And then this is going to be equal to 1 over 40j again, okay? Summation from n equals minus 10 up to 9. And then multiply the first by the first, so you'll end up with
cancel out the first one.
لا مفيش حاجة بتكنسل خالص.
No.
There is an R there. So there is no cancellation,
okay.
Right?
Okay.
So e to the j, right? 0.1 pi n, and then multiplied by 1 minus R. Okay? That's the first term.
Yes.
And then the second term is minus, and the second term is going to be, or you can do them even in two separate summations, okay? So let's do that. So because each summation is going to be dealt with separately. So this is 1, and then minus the summation for n equals minus 10 up to 9 again. And then we have inside e to the j, okay, 0.1 pi, multiplied by n, multiplied by 1 plus r. Okay? So that's the second summation. Okay? And all of this is multiplied by 1 over 40j. Now, there is a property that says, and you can find that explained further in the book if you are interested or you have studied it in your complex numbers study, that says that this summation, right, the first one, the one that goes from 10 to, one that goes from 10 to 9, right, okay, with this expression, this is equal to 0, the summation is going to be equal to 0 for all values of r, except at r equals 1, okay, so if you put r here, any value other than 1, which makes this part 0, right, the result of this summation, which is over one period, right, of e to the j multiplied by 0.1 pi n, and then another integer resulting from 1 minus r, this summation over one period is always going to be equal to 0. Except if you put r here equals 1, which is going to render the complex exponential being equal to?
It's
going to be equal to 1,
yeah.
Because this is going to be 0. So e to the power 0 is going to be equal to 1, right? So this summation is always going to be equal to 0 except at r equals 1. Similarly, this summation is going to be equal to 0 except at r equals minus 1, right? So basically, the result of this and the result of this are going to be for r equals 1 and for r equals minus 1, the value is going to be equal to what? La. For any other than r equals 1 and r equals minus 1, it's going to be 0. But at r equals 1 and r equals minus 1, what's going to be the value? Put r equals 1 here.
Yeah, yeah.
What's going to be the value, jama'a?
1.
1. 1. 1. 1.
1. You will add up from negative.
Yes. So how many?
So
you will add up 1 how many times?
20
times. So the result is going to be what?
20
multiplied by 1 over 40j. So the result is going to be? 20 multiplied by 1 over 40. Please, don't, at this, when r is equal to minus 1, this is vanishing. Tamam? When r is equal to 1, this is vanishing. When r is equal to minus 1, this is vanishing. So you don't add them together.
You don't?
This is why, okay. First, at r equals 1, what will happen to the first summation? 20. What will happen to the second summation?
Zero.
If a d, I'm looking at dr, huh? So d at 1 is equal to 20 multiplied by 1 over 40j, which is going to be equal to what?
1 over
2j, right? So the result is going to be 1 and d minus 1. These are the only ones that are going to have non-zero values. تمام? For d1, the non-zero value is going to be 1 over 2j. And for d minus 1, minus 1, because there was a minus, if you remember, over 2j. There were two summations, one positive and the other one negative. Right? It was summation minus summation. خلاص?
Okay.
So at d equals 1, it's going to be 1 over 2j. At d equals minus 1, it's going to be minus 1 over 2j. خلاص? And these are the only two coefficients, and d is equal 0. Dn dr is equal 0 for all, or you can write it this way, for all r not equal to 1 and minus 1, or not belonging to 1 and minus 1, right? So for all other values of r, the coefficient is equal to 0, and it's only equal to 1 over 2j for r equals plus 1, and it's equal to minus 1 over 2j for r equals minus 1. So that's your Fourier. So if you want to plot this, how it will look like?
2 points. The magnitude, right?
So yes, plot the magnitude. So okay, let's do the magnitude of dr. يا جماعة ركزوا معنا هنا. The last slide discussion.
Half from positive and negative.
Okay, so it's going to be
half.
1 over 2, right?
Half.
Here. And 1 over 2,
here.
Also here. This is magnitude, so it doesn't go negative or anything, right?
Yes.
At r equals minus 1 and at r equals 1, and it's 0 everywhere else. And if you want to plot the phase,
it will be 1 is down and 1 is up.
Like which one is down and which one is up?
The minus 1 is down, minus pi, and the other
minus pi or minus pi over 2?
Minus pi over 2,
right? So 1 over j results on minus pi over 2. So this is going to be minus pi over 2. This is the phase of dr. This is versus r, right? And the other one here is going to be pi over 2, right? So this is the magnitude and the phase. And then what happens? It will repeat. The same thing is going to repeat
every frequency?
Every n note points, right?
Yeah.
So 1, 2, 3, until you reach n note, all of these are going to be zeros. And then n note plus 1 is going to be, sorry, at n note is going to,
one.
You're going to have the same thing again at n note. Right? صح؟ ولا at n note plus
1.
n note minus 1 ولا n note ولا n note plus 1. This will appear where? How much away from this?
n
note points. So it should appear at?
n
note plus 1 ولا n note بس؟ Move يا جماعة. طيب.
N note plus 1.
Move N note points. تمام? So you start from 1 and then move N note points, right?
Yeah.
But it should appear at the point number N note. ولا N note plus
1.
N note plus 1. So this is going to appear at N note plus 1.
Yes.
تمام? And then it will repeat similarly from the negative and similarly for the phases. They are going to repeat as well. تمام?
Okay. This is like modulation, right?
Phase for the
positive
one shouldn't be minus j 1 over 2, so the phase
would be negative. Minus. The phase, first of all, it has nothing
to do with 1 over 2. 1 over 2
is magnitude. But here j, it's minus j. Yes. Minus j. Yes.
So negative.
For d equals 1, this is. This is the positive one. This is the negative one, and this is the positive one. You're right. Correct. You agree, أنت السبب الغلطة أصلا. I hold you accountable. Okay, so yes, you are right. So this should be the positive one. At the negative, because j is down, and then you multiply it by minus, it becomes positive j, which is pi over 2. صح. And this one should be the negative one. You are right. Correct. So minus pi over 2 at minus 1 and at plus 1, you are right. And then this is going to repeat as you go over the period n note. خلاص يا جماعة? Okay, thank you. Okay. So next. Okay. What if the signal is aperiodic? So again, similar to what we did in the time domain, we looked at the Fourier series expansion for periodic continuous time signals, and then we have to look at the Fourier transform of aperiodic, but in this case, discrete time signals, right? So Fourier transform for aperiodic discrete time signals, okay? This is typically called, okay, the discrete time Fourier transform. So it's called discrete time Fourier transform. And by the way, when you are using MATLAB to do Fourier transform, you are basically using discrete time Fourier transform. FFT is just an implementation. It's called the fast Fourier transform. It's just one efficient way to implement discrete time Fourier transform. In MATLAB, there is no continuous time signal processing in the regular MATLAB, okay? You cannot. You are only dealing with discrete time signals, but you try to make them close together such that they are similar to a continuous time signal. But in MATLAB, you cannot deal with the continuous time signal situation.
You will need the templates to...
Yeah, well, basically, or you need numeric techniques. So you can do that by numeric integrations and so on, right? But the typical MATLAB signal processing that you do is actually discrete time. Assume that everything is discretized. You have finite number of points. No matter how large you make them, they are still finite number of points, okay? And they are at discrete point times. They are not a continuous signal. But you make them close such that they look very close to a continuous time. So anyways, a discrete time Fourier transform is defined as follows. If I have a signal, x of n, which is discrete time signal, then the Fourier transform of x of n, which is a discrete time signal, we call it x, but instead of using the regular omega that we used to use there, we use the capital omega, as we mentioned before, when we deal with a discrete time case, we call our frequency domain variable, we call it capital omega, yeah. Okay? So x of capital omega is equal to the summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity, very similar to the definition of the continuous time, but instead of integration, we use summation. So it's x of n multiplied by the complex exponential e to the minus j, okay, omega n. Okay? Okay, and the omega here is the capital omega, okay?
Yeah.
Correct? Okay, so this is how you get from time domain signal, but discrete time, into frequency. Notice something very important, okay? Even though our signal in discrete, in time is discrete, its Fourier transform in the frequency is continuous. Why? Because it's not periodic. Remember in the previous, when it was periodic, when we did the Fourier series, the frequency domain representation was also discrete, right? But here, it's discrete in time, but it's not periodic. Then in frequency, it becomes
continuous,
because it's not periodic in time. But still, in frequency, it is periodic, because it is discrete in time. I'm going to summarize this in the next slide, okay? So anyways, this is how you get the Fourier transform. And typically, we don't use the expansion except in very special functions, such as, for example, unit step or delta function, right? But we typically, again, similar to the continuous time, you will have a table that shows you the Fourier transform, and you use the table and the properties to do the calculation of most of the transforms and also the inverse transforms. Not only that, look at how the inverse transform looks like. So x of k, if you want to get it from x of omega, if you know the frequency domain and you want to get the time domain discrete time signal, right? It's equal to 1 over 2 pi. And then you do the contour integral or the closed loop integral over, a continuous integral, not a contour integral, sorry, a continuous integral over a duration of 2 pi. Why over a duration of 2 pi? Because we know that the frequency in the case of discrete, the capital omega is periodic with period equal to 2 pi. We discussed this last lecture. In case you have a discrete time signal, right, its corresponding frequency domain representation, or its frequency is periodic with a period equal to 2 pi, and then it will repeat. So you integrate over 2 pi, f of omega, right? F, x, we called it x, not f. X of omega multiplied by e to the j omega n, and you integrate with respect to omega. Now, the problem with this integral is that you are integrating over a complex variable. So this is a complex integral. It's not contour, but it is a complex integral. It's not a closed loop integral, but it is an integration over the complex domain and very difficult to perform as well. So that's why we don't use this definition to calculate the inverse. We use tables again. But per definition, this is how you get the Fourier transform of a discrete time signal, and this is how you get the time domain from the Fourier transform if you want to do it like by integration. Otherwise, we typically use tables and properties. Now, what are the properties? Number one, notice that, that omega is, or x of omega, is continuous. Okay? Even though, x of n is discrete. Okay? So even though you start with a discrete time signal, when you look at it in frequency domain, you find that it has a continuous spectrum in frequency because it's not periodic in time. The second important thing to notice is that it possesses a very nice symmetry property, which is x of minus omega is equal to the conjugate of x of omega. So the negative side, right, if you take that x of omega and you flip it in frequency, right, if you take x of minus omega, it becomes exactly equal to conjugating the signal, which is basically taking every omega to be, if I say that omega is real plus imaginary, it becomes real minus imaginary, right? That's the conjugation, okay? So this is a very nice property. And then the third is that this is a linear transform. Again, similar to the continuous time Fourier transform, it's linear. So if the signal is multiplied by a constant, you multiply the frequency domain by the same constant. If two signals are added together in frequency domain, you add their Fourier transform together, right? So it possesses the linearity property. And the last thing is, for this to exist, to have a Fourier transform for a signal, a discrete time signal, it must be that the total sum of the signal from n equals minus infinity to infinity of the absolute of the signal, x of n, this must be less than infinity. And you remember, for the continuous, we said the integral from minus infinity to infinity, the absolute of x of t is less than some, is less than infinity, which means it's bounded, right? Then the amplitude of the signal is bounded, cannot go to infinity, okay? So that's the condition for the Fourier transform to exist, very similar in the discrete case, okay? Some of the important properties that you will use, again, very similar to the continuous time corresponding parts. That's why we go over them very quickly. Number one, inversion, whether in time or frequency. Okay, so x of minus n results in, if you invert the signal in time, this is exactly equal to inverting it in frequency, x of minus omega. Slightly different from the continuous time case. Yeah, okay. So this comes from the periodicity and from the symmetry property that we mentioned earlier, that the conjugate is eventually equal to x minus omega, right? So that's why here inversion in time is exactly the same as inversion in frequency. So whether you invert the signal in frequency, this means it's inverted in time, or you invert it in time, it's inverted similarly in frequency. The second part, the second property is, if I have, so the second is differentiation. Okay. I think there is something wrong with this. Okay. anyways, I think differentiation in time would be sorry, not differentiation in time. The property that I want to mention right now is not differentiation in time. It's multiplication by time. Multiplication by time. So if I have n multiplied by x of n, then this corresponds in the frequency domain j, and then dx of omega by d omega. Very similar to multiplication of time property in the continuous case. If you multiply the signal by time in time domain, this is equivalent to multiplication by j and differentiation in frequency domain. If you multiply, if x of n has a Fourier transform x of capital omega, then n multiplied by x of n is going to give you a Fourier transform j dx of omega by d omega. And then the third property, again, differentiation in time here doesn't mean anything because it's simply difference equation. So you can figure it out how it looks like in frequency domain, right? It's basically time shifting and addition or subtraction, right? So it doesn't need a special property. Time shift, okay? The time shift property says that if you have x of n minus n naught, so a time shifted version of x of n, then the Fourier transform of this is going to be multiplication by e to the minus j kn n naught, right, omega multiplied by capital X of omega. So time shifting by n naught with negative corresponds to multiplication by a complex exponential with a power n naught omega, right, and also with negative. So the exact same sign. Frequency shift property. Okay, it will look like this. It's going to be similar to the time, to the continuous time case. So if you have x of n, okay, e to the j n omega s, this comes from a time shifted x of omega minus omega s. Okay? So if you have a signal shifted in frequency by a value omega s, this result in the time domain representation being multiplied by e to the j n omega s, where omega s is the shift. And look, keep in mind that in this case, the shifting in frequency, the sign here is opposite to the sign here. Okay? And then the last two properties are convolution property. Okay, so convolution in time and convolution in frequency. So we have and in frequency. So x of n convolved with h of n will result in frequency domain x of omega multiplied by h of omega. And if I have the convolution in frequency domain, then it is multiplication in time. So if I have x of n multiplied by h of n, this is multiplication in time, then in frequency, this is going to be convolution subject to a factor 1 over 2 pi. So 1 over 2 pi x of omega convolved with h of omega. So multiplication in time results in convolution in frequency, but with a factor 1 over 2 pi. Convolution in time results in multiplication in frequency. And then the last, I said last two properties, so that was one, and the other one is Parseval's theorem. Basically, how to calculate the power in frequency domain, okay? So, or the energy in this case. So convolution in time and frequency, inversion, multiplication by time, time shift, frequency shift, and the last one is Parseval's, the energy, exactly, the energy of a signal x is equal to the summation from n equals minus infinity to infinity, the magnitude of x of n squared, right, which is basically from frequency domain equal to 1 over 2 pi, the integral over 2 pi magnitude of x of omega squared d omega, right? So you integrate the x of omega squared as magnitude with respect to omega over a period of 2 pi, and you multiply that by y over 2 pi. This gets you the energy from the frequency domain, which is equivalent to the summation of the square of the values of the signal in time domain, okay? And again, this is the energy. So that's Parseval's theorem.
So
yes, go ahead.
Have the duality property?
No.
No.
Yeah.
Because this was connected, right?
Yes. So we don't have a duality property here because of the fact that the signal nature in frequency and time are different. One is continuous, one is discrete. So the duality would be very difficult to deal with. Okay. Last thing, and that's in the substitute type, because we finished the lecture time. It's just a definition. I'm going to tell you about it, but we're not going to have examples on it. Okay. The Z transform. Z transform. This is an equivalent to the Laplace, which is like a more generalized transform, but in the discrete domain case. Okay. So the Z transform is defined for discrete time signals. Okay. So it's defined as x of z, okay, for a discrete time signal is equal to the summation of my discrete time x of n from n equals minus infinity to infinity, right? Multiplied by z to the power minus k. Where, to the power minus n. Okay, where z is a complex exponential. Remember, when we looked at two ways to represent a complex exponential, one of them we used in the continuous time, which was e to the st, right? Where s is a complex number. And then we said, okay, we can represent this as gamma to the power t, right? And now gamma to the power n. So our z is basically that gamma, which is e to the power S, right? So in general, it's a complex number. Z is a complex number. And again, when the real part in the S was negative, this was equivalent to the magnitude of Z being less than 1. You remember mapping the line, right? The imaginary line into a unit circle, right? And then the region to the right was the region outside the unit circle, which means Z magnitude is greater than 1. The region to the left, which is the real part of S, was negative, was equivalent to the one inside the circle, which is basically the magnitude of z is less than 1. So z, which is our transform variable, is actually a complex value. Okay, and that complex value is mapped to the polar coordinates, which has the unit circle outside the circle and inside the circle. So, and the if you want to get x of n from x of z, this is really, really complicated. It's 1 over 2 pi j, and then contour complex integral. So you integrate over a closed path in the complex domain, x of z multiplied by z, and to make things more complicated, it's to the power n minus 1 rather to the power n, right? Okay, and then you integrate with respect to the variable dz, okay, which is our complex domain variable. Okay, so z domain is a generalized frequency domain for discrete time, which is analogous to S domain for continuous time signals. خلاص يا جماعة. You'll study further about this if you take the digital DSP, the digital signal processing, whether you take it as elective for the old plan or you take it as mandatory for people who move to the new plan. And again, the region of convergence here is mapping to things outside and inside circles, right? Remember, in the S domain, okay, and this is the Z domain. Okay, so Z domain, region of convergence are some regions outside or inside certain circles. In the S domain, region of convergence were regions to the right or to the left of some vertical line, right?
Yes.
Okay, so that's the difference between the Z domain and the S domain. We're not gonna go into the details of the Z transform. Maybe we'll just have one problem and a very similar problem in the final. But we're not going to go into complicated stuff. So very, very simple transform that you can get from the table with a region of convergence. Okay. Again, we use tables to get